familiar faces. Hi, Helena. Hi, Jean.
Great. Well, huge welcome, everyone, as you're getting settled and dropping into this thematic breakout focused on policy and system change. Looking at the question, what is the role of policy and government incorporation in scaling up impactful solutions? And I am so, so thrilled that we have Susanna from Action Tutoring and Sarah from Get Further, who will be leading us through this thematic breakout. I'll hand over to them to take us through the session.
Great, thank you so much, Tisha. So we're going to focus this session talking about the National Tutoring Programme, which hopefully everybody has heard of by now. We're going to do a brief recap on how it came about and where it's got to, but what we really want to focus most of the time and the discussion on is what next. How can we continue to influence this policy to hopefully make it as successful as possible for the wider system? So if I could have the first slide, please, Tisha. Thank you. So how did the National Tutoring Programme come about? Well, not surprisingly, when the first lockdown back in March 2020 kicked off, there was huge concern in the sector about what the school closures were going to mean, particularly for disadvantaged pupils. And it didn't take long for tutoring to bubble to the surface as an effective intervention that could help to support that catch up. And there were various ideas kicking around for how that could be structured, whether that was giving schools additional funding to use as they wished to buy in tutoring or so on. And then eventually that formed into the idea for the National Tutoring Programme, where there would be more regulation and more oversight and more direction for schools over how they could best provide that tutoring support for pupils. And last year, 33 providers were selected to be part of the National Tutoring Programme and recommended to schools as a route to support the pupils with their catch up. Lots of collective action went into advocating for that policy, not least from a number of FEA member organisations, support collective letter signing. I was invited to give evidence to the government's Education Select Committee about the work that Action Tutoring have been doing in the tutoring space for a number of years. But we were really excited that that policy was launched and the funding made available. And last year, the NTP reached nearly 250,000 pupils. And this year, it has an ambition to go even further than that, to reach 500,000 through the tuition pillar strand, and then another 1 million through schools-led tutoring, which is a route by which schools can use their own funding to choose more local providers or use in-house tutoring support if they so wish. And I think what's been really exciting about all of that so far has been the pace and the scale of change. I think those of us working in this arena for so long would never have imagined we could reach quite so many pupils in need of support through tutoring at this speed. And I think the other thing that's been really exciting has been the way it's raised tutoring up the agenda, both within Westminster, but also amongst the public. Huge support from the public for this kind of programme. And with that, hopefully huge potential to drive some changes in the system. Now, it hasn't been all plain sailing. The contract, many of you will be aware, went to a different provider this year to manage the NTP programme, and that transition has created some issues. There have been additional factors some of us have been less than happy about, such as support is only provided in one subject rather than two, and certainly at Action Tutoring we find many pupils need support in both English and maths, and there's a cap that pupils receive 15 hours of tutoring support. And certainly at Action Tutoring, we like to take them for the full academic year. That might mean they only attend 15 sessions, but in theory, it should mean they can attend a lot more than that. So a great initiative, fantastic to have the funding, but working out how it can best work practically on the ground. And I'm gonna hand over to Sarah, who's going to talk a little bit about what the NTP has meant in the post-16 space, and also to reflect on some of the key lessons from our work in this area so far.
Thanks, Susanna. So yeah, when all the charity CEOs who work in tutoring came together when COVID hit, it wasn't just looking at the kind of school phase in terms of what the COVID response would be and what role tutoring would play in that, but also for the post-16 phase as well. And interestingly, for a few different reasons, the announcement that followed from the government in terms of a policy on tutoring was different and for post 16 than it was for pre 16. One example for a reason for that is that there is no post 16 pupil premium. And so often that sector gets treated quite differently. And just as some background for those of you who don't know much about the 16 to 19 tuition fund, which is essentially launched as the post 16 part of the MTP, it works differently in the sense that it's essentially a pot of money that gets allocated to post 16 providers, that's colleges, that's sixth forms, independent training providers. And it's allocated based on the number of students, the number of young people they have who are missing their GCSEs in English or maths at grade four, which is one of the Department for Education's indicators of disadvantage in the post 16 phase. And it works differently in the sense that there isn't a kind of application round for partners to come and be to deliver the tutoring. The money goes directly to colleges and sixth forms. They opt in to the allocation that they've been given, and then they can choose it in the same way that the school-led tutoring part now works for the NTP, where they can either choose to deliver that funding in-house, use their own staff, or they can choose to work with a third party, such as Get Further, and bring in some external support for tutoring. And there's pros and cons for the different models. For example, with the NTP, it's a lot easier to follow that funding, which will mean that in the long term, it should be easier to evaluate the impact of that policy and the outcomes that it has for young people. But with the 16 to 19 tuition fund, it's more flexible, and it does mean that providers were able to move quite quickly to get delivery happening when it was announced. So that's just a bit of context on the post 16 part, but these policies all sit underneath that broader banner of catch up tutoring policies in response to COVID.
Could we have the next slide, please?
Great. So this is for me to kind of reflect on, I think, in the first instance, so some of the key lessons that the tutoring advocacy group that we've been essentially running through the Fair Education Alliance have learnt over the past couple of years in terms of bringing about these national tutoring programme policies. The main one, I think, for me is that building that coalition for a policy change is really, really critical. And that means, bringing together all of those different external stakeholders that agree with this objective, that see the value in it, and bringing them together to campaign and to lobby, but with that laser-like focus so that everybody's on the same page in terms of what is being called for from government, and that the message doesn't get messy or mixed up. So really zoning in on the fact that, we are focused on, ensuring that there's a policy for tutoring, and it's tutoring for young people and children from disadvantaged backgrounds, and that is the key goal, even though there were lots of different things that were important in response to that, COVID recovery that went beyond tutoring and went beyond academic attainment, but that this was the thing that this particular group of stakeholders was focused on and essentially didn't deviate from was really key in making sure that happened, because it gave that clarity of message. And there were different, organisations who were involved in singing from the same hymn sheet there. For example, the Sutton Trust, you had the Education Policy Institute, you had Impetus PEF, you had Nesta, you had the Fair Education Alliance, and all of the different organisations that lent their voices to that campaign. And that was a big factor in why it was ultimately successful and the policy was announced. Another key lesson is that demonstrating the impact and potential impact, if it hasn't happened already, for these policies is really, really important to ensuring that they happen and that they continue to happen. I know from my policy background that some of the discussions and debates that would have been happening internally around whether to introduce a policy like the National Tutoring Programme, like the 16 to 19 Tutoring Fund, was all around, what impact is it going to have? What is that value for money? If we invest this much, what are we going to see at the end of it? And a lot of that debate happens between the Department for Education and Treasury. And if the Department for Education doesn't have, you know, that evidence to hand, it can't point to the fact that this intervention is going to, you know, lead to, you know, these positive outcomes, and it's going to, you know, reap rewards, and it's going to help to narrow the attainment gap and get students back on track. Then it's going to be harder for them to make that case for those policies to happen. And that's something that's, you know, an ongoing lesson for us as well. And this links to that positive storytelling point on the slide there, really. It is going to be natural when policies are announced, when there's a big amount of funding behind policies, when they're new, when they're innovative, that there will be some criticism in some way. You know, that's essentially just normal. So it's making sure that actually, you know, as you know, charity tutoring providers, that we're all coming together and continuing to demonstrate that positive impact from the programs that we're running, and that we're telling those positive stories of the young people that we're supporting and the difference that this policy is making to their lives, because these are the things that are going to make sure that when those discussions come back around again in terms of future spending reviews, manifesto commitments, that the department and the government have the evidence that they need to be able to make the case for extending them and embedding tuition into the education system for these young people for the long term. And then finally, this was sort of one of my reflections, but I'm wondering if some of the others within that tutoring advocacy group share the same experience, which is just basically being ready to scale and go with it. If you know, a campaign is successful and a policy initiative gets announced, you've got to move very, very quickly and make sure that you're actually able to deliver on all of those, you know, key messages around the opportunities that you've been setting out as part of that campaign. And it will mean, you know, dropping everything and making the most of that opportunity to make it work. So that's definitely something that, you know, I've been reflecting on. Can we have the next slide, Tisha?
Thanks, Sarah. So we've reflected a bit on how the National Tutoring Programme came about and where it's got to so far. But one of the things myself and other members of the Tuition Advocacy Group feel really strongly about is how we make the most of it now that it's a policy in motion. How do we ensure that tutoring really embeds in the system, is viewed positively, that schools want to continue it, and that there is a lasting legacy to the money that's been invested so far. When the National Tutoring Programme was announced, it was very much around the language of catch-up, but there's arguably a huge piece that the National Tutoring Programme could play in actually closing the attainment gap. And if you reflect that the UK has one of the largest attainment gaps in the developed world, and that was even pre-COVID, COVID's only made it worse, we should be really worried about that. We should be focused on that, and that's been talked about as part of the summit already today and the work that a number of organisations do on that attainment gap. But can we begin to shift the National Tutoring Programme narrative away from focus on COVID catch-up to actually this could be a really influential policy that could ultimately help to close the UK's attainment gap and have that really lasting impact for disadvantaged pupils? I've used the phrase a tutoring revolution there, which is a phrase that's been used quite widely, talking about the role that tutoring can play in education. There is a huge opportunity if the National Tutoring Programme can embed correctly to really leave a lasting change in the system, where it becomes really normal for schools to access tutoring for pupils that particularly need it, and for that just to be viewed as a standard part of our education system rather than just something that only exists in the private space or for wealthier pupils. So can we help schools as part of the NTP to really think about using tutoring for the long haul to support their disadvantaged pupils? At the moment, there isn't funding as part of the National Tutoring Programme to invest in evaluation. So we think it's really important that the individual tuition providers can continue to demonstrate the impact they make, and that therefore collectively we can demonstrate the effectiveness of this policy at scale? Because as Sarah rightly highlighted, that's what the Treasury are going to want to know about. Can we make that link between the money spent and the impact it's having on the ground? We believe there is plenty of great evidence there around tutoring, plenty of providers, FEA members and tutoring partners for the National Tutoring Programme have got that evidence. But can we join some of that evidence together, continue to share those positive stories and really demonstrate the difference that this policy can make at scale? But we do think that there is still work to do to achieve all of that, to shift the language back to the attainment gap, to really make sure it's embedded in the system and that the Treasury, schools and the public really see the value of it. So we're shortly going to open it up for discussion and would love to hear from you about ways you might be able to support us to achieve some of those goals. But just before we come onto that, I think Sarah's got a timeline to share leading up to the 2024 general election of some key things that we might all want to be looking out for as part of how we embed this legacy for the National Tutoring Programme. We have the next slide.
Thanks, Susanna. Thanks, Tisha. This slide is really to stimulate that discussion on, you know, what next, what more could we be doing to reach this goal? As Susanna mentioned, the National Tutoring Programme and the 16 to 19 Tuition Fund have been confirmed up to 2024. So that's essentially the end of this timeline, really, you know, looking at that point and working backwards, what opportunities are there coming down the line that we can all collectively, you know, work on together to ensure that we seize this window of opportunity to embed tutoring into the education system for children and young people from disadvantaged backgrounds for the long term, and so that it's a positive long-term legacy that comes out of the pandemic. And so looking, you know, starting at the end and working backwards, obviously a key milestone is the 2024 general election, assuming that it does happen in 2024 and not earlier, and that there will be a manifesto planning process for the main political parties in the run up to that general election. And so thinking about how, you know, what work we can do to make sure that the extension of this fund, that the inclusion of tuition is included in those manifesto commitments, is part of that process. So, you know, what work can we do with politicians over the next few years to make sure that that happens? There are obviously a few other ideas that we've thrown down here on this slide. It's not exhaustive. There will be lots of other ones, but we've talked about impact and positive storytelling quite a bit today. So we know that Ofsted are doing a review of tutoring. You know, that's a really potentially important opportunity to demonstrate the impact that these policies are having. The Department for Education is doing a formal evaluation of the 16 to 19 tuition fund. So that's another opportunity. As charity providers, as I've mentioned, we're all collecting our own impact data, we're collecting our own testimonials, so we should be thinking collectively and independently about how we get those stories out there, about the impact of these policies, how we work with the media, how we work with policy stakeholders and those in education research. There's a suggestion here of, you know, annual conferences. We know that the Education Policy Institute have one, I think, either this week or maybe it's just happened. But maybe there's an opportunity to partner with an organisation such as EPI and share some of the impact collectively that we're all having through those conferences to make sure that message is coming out. And things like, you know, surveys of parents will happen at some point within these next few years, asking them about, you know, their views on these policies. Can we be driving some of that forwards? Because it is a very popular policy with parents, and it will likely continue to be a very popular policy with parents. And that's something that's going to, you know, be basically another argument, another strength for that argument for the Department for Education and government for continuing this policy beyond 2024. So that's just a highlight of some things we could be doing. And then if we go to the next slide, Tisha, I think here are some questions for us to ponder on as part of this discussion.
So yes, we'd love to open it up. If you have questions you want to ask us or reflections you'd like to share with the wider group, about the NTP, we'd love to open it up for that. I think we've got about 8 minutes, judging by Suan's comment in the chat, although 3 minutes according to the time ticker at the top, but we've got a few minutes. We've also put some questions there for you to be thinking about. Can you share what we're trying to achieve around the NTP with your wider networks? Put us in touch with people who might be helpful and influential in this space. We're always keen to have new members join our tuition advocacy group, but tell us what you think. Or if you don't like to speak, you could always post your comment in the chat. And maybe actually if we stop the screen sharing, we can put it onto gallery view and see everybody's faces. Great, we've got a hand from Richard. Thank you.
Thanks very much. That was very interesting. Listening, I was comparing your experience with the establishment of the Careers Network, which has been by a lot of measures very successful and is institutionalized and embedded, and the government's continuing to fund it. The difference, it seems to me, is that schools mostly would readily recognize that employers and others coming in from outside will know more about what they're talking about than they will on the world, about the world of work. Yours is the opposite. You're going to have to convince teachers that the people you're going to bring in are really going to be the equivalent of what they're already doing to help young people attain in the subjects where they're behind. How do you handle this whole question of quality, which I think is what the department's always going to be nervous about?
And I think really that was the whole reason behind the policy launching in a very structured way, rather than just initially giving schools funding to bring in any tutors they wanted. I believe there were over 400 tutoring organisations that applied to be part of the tuition partners pillar of the NTP. And from that, only 33, someone's going to correct me, somewhere in the early 30s were selected for that final list of providers. So sort of less than 10% actually making the cut. And it was a really rigorous application process. I'm sure others on this call will testify to that, that it was a lot of work that went into pulling the application together, demonstrating the quality around tutor recruitment, ongoing monitoring, our understanding of working with disadvantaged pupils, and then of course really important factors such as safeguarding policies and procedures, but a really rigorous selection process so that hopefully schools that are going down that tuition partners route can have real assurance about who it is that they're bringing in to work with their pupils. But I think, Richard, you make there's an interesting broader point in this around the lack of regulation in the tutoring industry, which is something that I know several people in this call are concerned about, that in theory, anyone can set themselves up as a tutor and a parent could hire them in. So it's an issue not just for schools in terms of the quality, but also for parents. And there are wider conversations beginning to bubble up in the sector around, should there be more regulation of the tutoring industry, not just for schools, but amongst private providers that parents are using as well.
Just to jump in super quickly and just share the Pro16 perspective, because the fund works differently. We do find a lot of colleges come to us who potentially tried to recruit their own tutors and they've struggled. And so they work with us to get the talent into the sector. And that's actually reflective as well of the fact that some colleges then like to offer some of the tutors positions within their college in the longer term, because they, you know, essentially see it as a pipeline of getting some new talent into the sector. And the department's reached out to us to talk about, you know, whether there's a way we can kind of do that more formally as well. So it can, you know, be a big opportunity for the schools and colleges to work with external providers too.
I'm going to come to Grace, because you had a hand up, Grace from the Prince's Trust. And if anyone else wants to put a hand up, we might have time for one or two more questions or reflections.
I'll go quick in case we get kicked out of the room quickly. But my question was more specifically on the influencing side and how, with the kind of specific focus on tutoring, you found the reshuffle and the kind of change in leadership within the Department for Education, if that had much impact on what you guys are doing.
I mean, I think we're hopeful it might, in terms of some scrutiny over how the NTP is being run and delivered. I think there's an opportunity for a new minister.
Welcome back, everyone. I know I was in the policy and system change room and the conversations were still going there. Please do note any comments from each of the rooms into the chat if you would like to pick up the conversations. Really encourage you to reach out directly to people, share contact information and pick those conversations up post-event. So I want to kind of just give just a short time to give a space or a flavour from each room. So I'm going to pick on a kind of three award winners to share kind of a highlight from their room. So Owen, would you mind sharing kind of a reflection from your room in terms of data-driven decisions?
Yeah, one really helpful, just interesting discussion that we were having going actually towards the end is around not just using kind of data in the here and now, but more systematically collecting data on long-term outcomes, and particularly in a place-based way as well. And Kat was able to share some really interesting examples of the work that School Home Support are doing in relation to that. So I think, thinking really deliberately about building the relationships with your partners to collect data for longer-term periods that can help you understand your progress in a more sustained way. It's definitely kind of key theme that I think a lot of organisations are thinking more systematically about.
Thank you, Owen. And yeah, really great to see that as a pattern emerging from your room. I think the more we can use data in a really kind of strategic way to influence what and where we scale, the better outcomes we can achieve across the system. Susanna, if I can come to you for a reflection from your room.
Thank you. We didn't get hugely far into our discussion time, but we did touch on some interesting questions around the quality with tutoring and how you convince schools that the people that you're going to be bringing in will be valuable for them. But some kick-started, hopefully, some thinking for people around what the long-term legacy of the National Tutoring Programme could be, how we embed it in the system and how we could use it to ultimately close the attainment gap.
Thanks, Susanna. And I think that is a beautiful kind of illustration of this kind of top-down and bottom-up approach that is needed when we're thinking about policy and system change. We need to think strategically about how we're influencing on that department level, of government level, but also we need to really be thinking about how do we change the attitudes of people on the ground? So who we're going to be benefiting and kind of who are our clients and users essentially, and how do we kind of influence them to really kind of recognise the quality and the impact of what we deliver. Thanks, Susanna. Evie, if I can come to you for your room, for any reflections from your room on beyond direct delivery.
Yeah, absolutely. So again, I wish it was five times as long, but we were talking mostly around the, obviously, beyond direct delivery and those creative approaches to scaling our impact as organisations. I think a couple of key takeaways for me that we discussed, although there were obviously many more, were around, you know, really changing how we think about how we scale our impact, changing how we think about what those kind of success metrics are and kind of those, how we use that to frame our growth and our strategy as organizations. I think a couple of other interesting points as well were, you know, a lot of discussions around partnerships and collaboration and how that can help us to scale our impact in multiple ways, but also thinking about that lasting legacy of impact, which is a really interesting point from Schools Builder at the end of the session, which has resonated with me, which is about, yeah, thinking about that lasting legacy in terms of another approach to scaling our impact as well. So yeah, lots discussed and thank you for the time, but wish we had more.
Thank you, Evie. And that really kind of resonates and take you back to kind of as a very great paper based on what your end game is as an organization and how will you best kind of achieve that in terms of your end impact and the best route to achieve that. So I've already thanked our members and business members, Credit Suisse, who fund the award, but I just also wanted, just before we wrap up this session, give a big, huge thank you to the award winners who have really embraced the ethos of peer learning support and collaboration, not only to kind of really feed into this award and making it a cohort award that supports each other, but also for this really strong role that they play in across our collective action work, our policy influencing work, and the work of the alliance. high and small broadly. Really looking forward to seeing what the reminder of the second year of support brings and working with you this year, and also looking forward to see what you achieve in this next year, building on the incredible work across the last 18 months. A reminder to all our members that the Scaling Award will be open for applications in the summer of 2022. And I'm sure that that time will pass very quickly. So we'll look forward to hearing from those interested. And if you have any questions, please don't hesitate to get in touch before then. We are going to introduce a short poll now. Please do fill these in before we hand over to a last plenary to close for the first day. You can see the poll up on your screen. There are a few questions, so make sure that you're scrolling down to reach the fourth question and the fifth. So yeah, please do fill those in. I can see the answers coming. Great to see those coming through. Great. Brilliant. And as I'm kind of seeing more and more of those coming through, I will hand over to Sam and Gina to wrap up for the first day. Please do complete that poll before we leave.
Great. Well, thank you so much to all of our Scaling Award winners. Thank you so much to all of our collective priority session leads, to Vanessa, to our literacy pirates, to Paul Dreschler, and to all of you for your contributions today. I can't believe it's been a whirlwind 3 hours and 50 minutes, but I have taken away so much already and really excited to see you this evening and then tomorrow. So we are going to get your thoughts. Thank you so much for doing the poll. I think we'll keep that open for about maybe Daniel, 10 more seconds or so, and then we can go ahead and close that. And we're going to have you reflect on today. And the reason we're doing polls throughout and this now survey is because we want to get immediate feedback. It's really helpful for us to be able to learn and to iterate and make changes immediately so that we are having this be as much member-led as possible. So there are three things that we would love to get from you, and we'll put the link. It is sending you to an external link for Microsoft Forms. And it is, if you can share one word to describe how you're feeling after the first day, what is one thing that you'll do today as a result of attending the sessions, and critically, what's one thing you want to get out of tomorrow? So any comments, feedback, what you're looking to get out of tomorrow, it will really help us to shape and make any iterations this afternoon. So we'll give you a couple of minutes to do that now. And take your time, and then we'll be coming back together to talk about next steps, pizza dinners, and all that awaits there. So thanks so much, Daniel, for putting the link in the chat. If you if you want to take a second and fill that out, that'd be great.
Just give us a message if you're not able to open that form for any reason. It should be in the chat from Daniel. You should be able to open it up and fill in the three questions. Just give us a shout if there's any technical issues with opening that.
Fantastic. We have about a quarter who have submitted so far, so take a couple more minutes. This is really important for us, so we'll give about 2 more minutes or so. Take your time.
Fab. So I think we'll keep them coming. I think we've got about 35 responses in now. So if you can keep them filling in while we wrap up. And I'll just wrap us up with some final information. So looking forward, first of all, to tonight. I can see some exciting messages in the chat about people at the Stratford dinner meeting up. So hopefully lots of you are looking forward to your pizzas this evening. You'll all be meeting at the restaurants at 6 p.m. Some of the dinners will have a staff member there. Some of them will have a board member, but some of them are just member to member. So you'll be meeting with approximately 5 to 20 of your fellow members and having some intimate conversations over pizza about your journeys today over the last year. So bring your fever curves that we discussed earlier and how we can work together to tackle education inequality. So enjoy that this evening. And then looking forward to tomorrow, we'll be kicking off at 9 a.m. again with a keynote from Dame Rachel D'Souza, the Children's Commissioner, but also interviewed by two young people themselves, which we're really excited for. So that'll kick us off. We've then got another spotlight on some of our Innovation and Entrepreneurship Award winners tomorrow. Then some more networking and ability to meet some of your members and get to know each other a little bit better. This time on the theme of looking forward to the next year, what we want the next year to look like. And then finally, we have our strategy session, which is us all looking forward collectively as to what we're going to do in the Fair Education Alliance in the next year and beyond, and how you guys can get involved. So we really hope we see you there. See you at the dinners tonight. Have a wonderful afternoon. And thank you so much for all participating and filling in the forms at the end. Hopefully you've all got those in now. So thank you so much. The form will continue to be open, so keep filling that in if in the next hour or so. And wishing you all a wonderful afternoon. See you tonight and tomorrow. I think it's just us guys, so you want to come off slides, Ellie?
Yeah, it's just us now. I've just removed everyone else.
Woohoo! Well done, everybody.
Hey, well done. Woo!
Wow, that was amazing.
Yahoo! That song could never be more accurate than it'll say no. Well done. How seamless. Yeah, maybe like a duck, but how seamless. Nobody knew what was happening underwater. It was such brilliant teamwork.
Amazing, guys. Thanks so much. Everything seemed really, really seamless and just seemed to flow. And where things might have been kind of missed, etc., people just picked them up anyway and realized they needed to happen. It was literally amazing. Like, because I wasn't in a lot of the breakout rooms and stuff, I was able to just kind of watch it and make sure it's happening, and everything just seemed really good from my angle. So I think we will break now and let everyone have a break, have some lunch, have something to eat, have a comfort break, regroup, and then we will come back on the Zoom link. There's a fresh Zoom link at 2 p.m. just to kind of regroup and do a little roundup session. But everyone go take a break and give yourself a big pat on the back.
Can we do a quick photo first, if I do a snipping? Yeah. We haven't done a team photo, so maybe one for the social media right now. So, oh, it was great with Vanessa last year as well, when we were all like, yeah, I will count you down. No, geez, I loved that. All right, ready? 1, 2, 3, woo! Ah, great. Amazing. Perfect. I will share that. It's so good. I'm going to share it in WhatsApp right now. Brilliant. Oh my gosh. And yeah, collectively well done. And Abby, great job. This is tremendous. And what an achievement. The comments, the attendance, it was all fantastic and could not have been done without your leadership and all of the team's effort.
Yeah.
Bravo, everybody. Thank you, Abby. And yeah, rest up and then we'll regroup. Is it 1 o'clock, Abby, to regroup?
No, 1 o'clock is now. We'll read 2 o'clock. 2 o'clock.
This is maybe where my like miracle summer energy just collapses. And you're in an hour, you'll see me and I'll just be like broken again. And then I'll be back on again tomorrow. yeah. Cool. Right. I need this lunch break. I don't know about all of you. See you at 2.
Bye.
Hey guys. Bye.
Bye.